I came to CJR in September of 2016, and the job that I thought I was going to do changed completely 2 months later with the election. There's been a lot of challenges and there's been a lot of scary moments, but in general, I think it's been really good. I think it's really forced journalists and journalism to think about some really fundamental issues about how we go about doing what we're doing. What's the balance between fact and opinion? How do you deal with a president that's attacking you all the time? Do you respond or do you let that go? And, you know, CJR, which has been around since 1961 and has for years been a sort of valued authority in this area, really came into its own. Because people, both people in journalism and people outside of journalism, were needing some guidance. I mean, it's such an unsettled moment. And a place like CJR is one of the places that people have turned to sort of try to make sense of this moment that we're in.
So in our fall 2017 issue, I had a little sidebar called The 10 Best Days in Journalism, which referenced this period that the Washington Post and New York Times were battling it out for scoops. Back in May of 2017, President Trump had just fired FBI Director James Comey, and these two newspapers were battling for the story, to get to the bottom of it. And basically, I had spent those 10 days every morning at 4:30 getting up, reading the reporting from the evening before, adding analysis, and trying to bring a summary of that story to our newsletter readers each morning.
Since the election, we decided to devote an entire coverage area to Trump, and we diverted people who were doing other things to covering Trump and his effect on journalism. We found that there was just it's really insatiable appetite for everything that we do, so we created a daily newsletter that goes out every morning to people in the business who want to know just what happened yesterday. We find that whenever we write stories about how to deal with a president like this, it resonates around the world, because when you think about it, there are people like Trump in a lot of parts of the world that it didn't really, frankly, dawn on me until we started running these stories and we started hearing from India, from reporters there who are having similar problems, from Europe where there's a nationalist movement that's also attacking the press, even from Japan where there's some press issues there. So this is a global phenomenon that we're living through here.
But on a day-to-day basis in the office, it means calling up reporters at newspapers, magazines, different publications, trying to understand the trends in the industry, what we're doing well as journalists, and where we might be falling short, as well as trying to analyze what to do with this ever-present financial reckoning that the industry is constantly facing.
We're also covering the role of Facebook and Twitter and the social networks in journalism, both as distributors of content, but also as contributors to these filter bubbles that we're living in, and even as in playing a role in distributing fake news and more malevolent content. So that's an important area for us, because those companies have been covered primarily as tech companies, and we're really covering them as journalism players. And I think it's an important part of the debate. And it's an important role for CJR, again, to play in sort of highlighting what they're doing and what they should be doing.
So moving into a space where we do a combination of reporting and criticism was definitely something new. And to do that in the first year of a new administration, and of this administration in particular, kind of means that work never really stops, because the news cycle has just been so insane. So everything happens quickly, and it's happening all the time, all night and all day.
But I also think one of the ways that we add value to the industry is to be able to step back. And that's something that we talk about a lot in here, is being able to say, okay, let's slow down from following every tweet. Let's slow down from trying to be on every story and step back, say, where is the industry headed? What are we as journalists doing well? Where are our blind spots? And I think that's CJR's role. And I think that we are hopefully adding something to the conversation in that way.
The mission now is somewhat different, and we still do stories about how best to get sources, how best to go about writing stories, but it's a much broader mandate. The mandate now is to just talk about what is journalism's role in a democracy, what is journalism's role In terms of keeping people informed and keeping power in check, and our mandate is just much bigger. When we think of what is a CJR story now, we think of that person who is in a newsroom at a keyboard, but we also think more broadly, just about if there's somebody who's just interested in information and how it comes to be, if there's somebody who's just interested in, like, how does the news make it into my Facebook feed, that's a CJR story now. So the idea of sort of starting with people in the business and then just sort of broadening it way out is sort of the way we think about what we do.